G'day and welcome to the very, very first iRide Live. My name's Steve and tonight we're going to be producing or presenting to you this motorbike show. So it's about motorbikes, for motorbike riders, by motorbike riders. The whole concept of the show is it's all about interaction. We want you to give us feedback, we want you to make comments, get on your keyboard, start tapping away, start hitting those comments and let us know if you're there. In fact, I want you to let us know where you're viewing us from. We're in Brisbane, we're at the Smoked Garage in Brisbane, but you may be in Canada or Indonesia or Sydney or Tasmania, wherever, just jump on the keyboard and say, hey, g'day, watching from. That'd be great to let us know. Thank you very much for that. So before we kick off tonight, we're just going to talk about this venue, and in a moment I'm going to introduce you to Shane, who's the owner of Smoked Garage, and he's going to kind of tell us a little bit about the background of this and how it started and why there's a motorcycle themed garage cafe kind of fabrication shop. So that should be really cool. We'll get to that in a moment. We're going to, I suppose there's a couple of key things we need to talk about before I introduce you to the guys. There's a couple of things you need to know. One is we're not media personalities, we're not motorcycle professionals, we're not journalists, we're not, you know, ex-riders or any of that sort of stuff. We're just passionate motorcycle riders, just like you guys. And, you know, bear with us because this is live and we're kind of all new to this. Now, while we may be new to this, the guys behind the crew, the camera guys, are really, really experienced. So hopefully at the end of the night, you'll be able to say, wow, that was a really, really slick production. We've got cameramen and light guys and sound guys and producers and directors, and this is a really, really quality show with guys with lots and lots of experience. So the production should be good, but we'll try not to stuff it up too much. So we're just going to talk a little bit about the team here tonight. So we've got Bob and Kylie, and Bob's actually going to be our content manager. He's going to manage the comments and the feedback that you guys are giving. He's going to take care of all that. Kylie is really going to give us that perspective. I mean, there's been such a growth in female riders in all disciplines of motorcycling, whether it be motocross or, you know, road or track or adventure riding. Such a huge growth by women riders, and even the people watching tonight, there's a lot of women riders out there viewing tonight. So really glad that Kylie could be here and participate and actually share that perspective that's a little bit unique in what has been traditionally a very blokey kind of activity. But before we get on with the show, Bob, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, thanks. Yeah, I got the job of hopping behind the keyboard and answering the questions. So I don't know how I did that, given I can't spell. But anyway, I'm no expert either, but I am a passionate bike rider and I love sticking the helmet on and going for a ride. And I've been fortunate enough to ride dirt tracks all over Australia, most of which as the crow flies, all with the same theory of having a tight swag and a loose plan. So I'm going to use that theory tonight when I'm answering the questions. So before I hop on the keyboard, I'll hand you over to Kylie.
Awesome. Thanks, Bob. And welcome, everyone. A motorbike show. How exciting. And it's live. Steve mentioned earlier, we are not professionals. We're just passionate bike riders, just like you. So we're hoping to bring to you tonight a really fun and interesting show and an interactive show as well. Now a little bit about me. Well, I've been riding for many years. I've had several bikes along the way, mainly sports bikes, but it wasn't until I met my husband in 2007 that I started riding more seriously.
Oh, happy anniversary, can you believe today, right?
It is. Thanks.
The 12 years? Or you can't remember?
No, I can never remember. He can always remember that. You put me
I'm
off.
I'm sorry.
What I was going to say.
Met your husband, rode a motorbike.
Yeah. And so then I started riding more seriously, and then in 2010 I started a ladies only motorcycle group called Kaiser Motorbikes, which is based on the Gold Coast. We have a lot of fun and a lot of adventures on the way, and I'm also the coordinator for the Gold Coast Black Dog Ride, which is a charity event to raise awareness of depression and suicide prevention. And that's me. So
awesome.
Can you tell us about you, Steve?
Sure, absolutely. Well, I kind of fit into that category of riders, like so many of us, where we kind of started out riding when we were young. I think I was 11, riding my brother's, you know, elder brother's bikes when I was just a kid. You know, got my license when I was about 20, about 17. It was one of those country towns where the cop just made you ride up and down the street, said, yep, you can ride, and gave you your license. So that was me. But when I had my license, I just disappeared. I was, you know, riding road bikes everywhere and just did lots of really big trips on the road bike. I had my philosophy when I was 21 was that if you had everything you owned couldn't fit on the back of a motorbike, you had too much stuff. That was kind of, and actually trying to get back to that now too. But I did the whole, got married, mortgage, family, kids, all that sort of stuff. And so really we're just in a situation where that took over for a while, never lost my passion for motorbikes, but have recently come back into it over the last 5 years and bought a motorbike and just realised that passion was the spark and it lit up, and then bought another motorbike and another motorbike.
Like seven bikes.
Now I've got seven bikes.
One bike for each day.
Absolutely. So really that's kind of us, and you'll get to know us as we progress with the show. We've got some really great guests coming on and we're really looking forward to presenting this show for you. But Kylie, what's coming up next?
Yeah, so next we are going to have a quick short break and we're going to welcome Shane Koval from Smoked Garage, this wonderful venue here.
Awesome. Well, welcome back. Oop, thanks, Bob. See? So we're here tonight with Shane Koval, who's the owner of Smoked Garage. Fantastic venue, mate. Just
cheers,
super
mate.
Impressive. Yeah, really, really good. So Shane, just I suppose most of the viewers that may not have been here before, just tell us a little bit about kind of why you started a motorbike themed garage. Where did you get the idea for that?
I honestly think the public wanted something different in Brisbane.
Yep.
You know, the valley's been in a bit of a slump for the last 5 years, they say, for culture.
Yep.
And, you know, we come across the building. Back in the day, it was supposed to be an old brothel. It's from the old Fitzgerald inquiries.
Okay.
And it's just got good bones. It's just an old, nice building.
Yep.
And, we made it home for the last 15 weeks now. So, yeah, it's good.
Fantastic. You had another location down the road, though, so people...
Yeah, we're in Bridge Street in Fortitude Valley.
Right.
I think for about 2 years.
Yep.
And, look, it was really humming. We had some great gigs down there and built a lot of bikes, but... the building was sold. So once the building was sold, we were only leasing the property at that stage. And it just got to the point where the new owner was getting out of control with what he wanted. And and I think at the end of the day, by the time we negotiated, we could actually buy our own, for payments wise. So hence we've entered this property now and we've got some big things happening. So Brisbane will be good.
It's an awesome place. Yeah. We'll probably show you some footage of it now, actually. It's amazing in here. Really beautiful.
So the whole bike modification thing that you're doing, is that kind of was part of the business plan?
Yeah, the business plan has always been...
A bit more than just coffee?
Yeah, you've got to diversify these days.
Yep.
If you want to go broke fast, open a custom motorbike shop.
Right.
Everyone will tell you that because, you know, you put so much time and effort into something and, you know, it's hard to make sure that, you know, the product's exactly what the customer wants.
Yeah.
And we've just managed to... do it quite well in Brisbane, I would say. You know, if not, we're right up there with the big players now.
Yep.
So it's good. Yeah, enjoying it.
We're going to have a look at the workshop a little bit later on.
You'll be talking to Vince.
Talking to Vince, and
he'll talk your ear off.
Let's hope so.
Yeah.
The whole idea behind customising motorbikes is not a new concept. I mean, people have been doing it since motorbikes that had two wheels.
Yep.
What do you find are the things people are looking for more these days?
You know, these days you'll just find the concept to creation is in 6 to 8 weeks.
Okay.
So a lot of people will just say, hey, look at the image I found. You know, that's the one I want.
Right.
You know, can you build that?
Yeah.
And look, you've got to sit them back down and bring back down to life and say, well, where's your budget?
Yeah.
What sort of bike do you want to start with?
Right.
And how long and you know, what concept do you want to create?
I think you mentioned earlier one of the issues that you've got is people showing you pictures of bikes from the United States where they don't have the same kind of regulatory.
The internet's such a powerful tool these days, and Instagram, and everyone's, you know, Instagram famous these days.
Yep.
So there's so many images over there and you just look at it and, you know, you go, okay, well, let's make that. You know, might have a front brake or a front guard. We try to do everything by the book,
absolutely.
Because then you wouldn't be able to register them, I guess.
Exactly. You know, we've learnt as we've gone as well. I think, like, all the new ADR compliance and rules do vary from state to state.
Right.
And we just find now that if we're doing it to a compliance level, the customers are happy, and at the end of the day, it makes it, you know. And that's what it's all about. At the end of the day, they're their blood, you know, they're a bloodline of our culture. So
we're just looking at some footage of the cafe area and that front kind of servery. Do you find you get a lot of traffic through there
during
the week?
If you're looking at the footage now, when we got the building, it was just nothing. It was just, you know, we built all the bar, we did all the form work, we built the front cafe, we did put all the roller door in.
Where did designs come from? Like, where?
Just inspiration, just travelling. Yeah. You know, my wife and myself have been to Bali, New York,
yeah.
Dubai, and you just see how I love Australia. You see how far we could go in the next 5 to 10 years on what we're bringing to it.
Yep.
And just like with the bike that you see on footage at the moment, you know, it's one of our original Indonesian builds that we did in Bali in 2010, and it's, you know, got the likes of some, you know, major media forms and stuff.
Yeah,
and it actually transforms. The actual tank on this actually pops up, and maybe Vinny can show you a bit later on what happens with the bike. But,
yeah,
you know, it's a Ducati 8x8. So.
Okay. I was wondering what sort of engine was it.
Yeah, it's pretty wild.
Yeah,
it's about a year's worth of work there.
Wow, okay. Yeah. And all the fabrication's done in-house?
Yeah, all of our stuff, like, that you see pretty much on the floor, and obviously what, you know, what's behind the camera and obviously on the side, it's all done in-house here.
Just come down and have a look, right? Just
yeah, exactly. Down, yeah, the only thing that we don't do in-house is our seat work, our leather work.
Okay.
We've got a bloke that does that. I think it's a pretty niche market.
And what about your painting, custom painting?
Yeah, you'll see Antonio, he does all our custom paintwork and some of the helmets you see on to your left as well, and does all our tanks and guards. He's really expensive, but he's really good.
Yeah.
I just had a go at him about it before he was giving me a bill, and I just went,
okay. So is there a particular build you've done that you're really proud of?
Look, we originally did one called the Bronco,
right?
And it was named after, obviously, my favourite team, anyway.
Right.
So. And, you know, we've got a good
Brisbane-based show, right?
Yeah, of course. And, it's got pretty much world headlines. You know, funny, we didn't think it was going to go as far as it did.
Yep.
But it was replicated off another bike, and people were saying, oh, you know, should you build it? We did, you know.
Yeah. Yep.
The concept of creation was probably a good 9 to 10 months in the making.
Wow.
Just to mill everything and make sure everything's perfect on it.
Yep.
You know, because obviously once we finished it, we did wanted to showcase it.
It's a pity we don't have any footage, I suppose, as a hashtag.
Yeah, you'll be able to find it.
Yeah. On the net. Yeah, okay, cool.
Any questions at all, Bob, about? No? Okay.
Is there anyone watching,
one?
Bob?
Yeah. maybe a meow or something.
Hello, is there anyone out there? No, the whole idea of using this as a venue was obviously because it's motorcycle themed.
Yeah.
You're a rider? Like, or is it just...
I can't ride to save myself. No, I go okay.
Yeah.
Look, doing this here, we can't believe the support we've had, not only from the support to actually doing functions and from a corporate level.
Right.
And we've had some big names just based on people that are coming in and wanted to book the venue. You know, we've got some big corporate clients now that we've organised big parties at the end of the year.
Yeah.
They want to do the, you know, 500 odd people and stuff.
Yeah.
And I think it's the culture, the look of the place.
Yep.
The bikes bring up a really good theme to it as well.
Yep. Yeah.
And, you know, they all want to be a part of that sort of new and fresh sort of look. And, and hopefully we can bring that sort of culture to Brisbane because it needs it. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Definitely. Yeah, no, I love it. It's great.
So, can you hang around for a bit? So we're just going to run. No. Well, you got to lock up, right?
I mean, we start at 7. So no, I'll hang around if you
want. Yeah, okay. Yeah, we just want to run a short clip. And,
yeah. So well, we've met a lot of amazing people out while riding, obviously. But this is our first iRide story, and it's a young paraplegic man who inspires us all. He is very inspirational for sure. Sorry. And his name is James Powell.
A lot of people don't realise, but you use your legs for balance, and when you don't have your legs to balance, it's a different feeling. 2009, it was on the way to work. And I was 20, 21, 22 at the time, which is pretty young to have a significant accident. My partner at the time, who's now my wife, she was a good support. My family, my dad, my mum, all those even friends. And because they had such a good attitude, it sort of kept me going. Even when I was doing my rehab, I had to learn how to balance on the side of a bed again. And the way I would do it was I'd try and touch my girlfriend's boobs to figure out how I could balance again. So it was all those sorts of things that I could try, and I had to sort of you can either laugh or cry about it, and I chose to laugh about it. It's the hardest thing about cooking a vegetable, and it's getting the wheelchair in the oven. So that was one of my best mates. He'd come in and sort of said that to me as we were going through it. So that humour was a huge part. It was massive. Basically, the only way to get on back on the bike was generally a quad bike. I think it was about probably about 18 months to 2 years after my accident, I sort of went and bought a Can-Am Renegade 1000cc quad bike, and it was loose. It was a mean machine, that thing. This was about 4 or 5 years after my accident, and researching motorcycles, and my wife wasn't too keen about me getting back on the motorcycle, so I was stuck with the quad for a little bit longer, and it all got to a point where I was like, no, it's not working. And that's when I looked at other options and went, how can I modify a motorbike? I was in my dad's office one day, and he turned around and he said, did you realise they've got an automatic dirt bike now, adventure bike, that New Africa Twin? And I went, rightio, let's do it, let's look into it. It was quite awkward when I rocked up at the dealership and I said, I want to buy your Africa Twin, the DCT. But I mean, and I rolled in a wheelchair. He sort of looked at me like I was crazy. There was nothing out there for a dirt bike. They were all road bikes, and anyone that was on a dirt bike sort of put a frame around their legs and used people. And I said to myself, I want to be mobile, I want to be independent. I was an aviation engineer by trade, and I had my accident partway through my apprenticeship. And I know that a lot of linkages and movements on the aircraft were very similar to what I was actually looking at originally when designing, when I was seeing designs over the internet for bikes. So I started prototyping, and the first prototypes were just, they were just crap. So the first time I tried it, basically I built an L-shaped style stand that held the back wheel in place, and I had two catches, and off I went. I rode and saw what I could or couldn't do, even just to see if my balance is okay. So I sort of rode around and realised that I could do that, and then what I would do was pull up beside the side of my ute or something, because it has a cage on the back, or even the side of the shed, and just pull up beside it and just basically hit the brakes, stop, and just lean into it. And that was the only way I could really do it in the early days. So the actuator extends out, and with the press of a button, which then turns like a torque tube, which lifts my gear up and down wherever I want it. And then I've got two control rods that basically angle the wheels out to when I'm coming down, to give me that stability out wide. Once I found out where the actuator was going to sit and how I was going to link both the arms, it was basically, that was the easy bit then. It was onwards and upwards. During the prototyping, there was a couple of fails. You know, when as soon as the bike heats up, the resistance changes, and then regulator failed. So I was going along, I was riding around the backyard, testing it out, and my regulator failed, so I couldn't put my gear up or down, so I was sort of like riding around in circles going, help me, help me. The other thing too was learning how to use it and how it reacts. I was at a set of traffic lights, bringing it down, and I thought, oh, they'll turn green soon. And so I hit the wrong button, and I hit the up button instead of the down button, and I did nothing but fall on my side. I sort of just went, uh-oh, here we go. I enjoy riding. I've met new people. Go out riding with my dad most of the time, which is, I think, is fantastic. So even riding with a bunch of people that, you know, they come out specifically because they think you're an inspiration. I don't see myself as that. I just see myself as the average Joe Blow going for a ride. But it's opened up what I would have been able to do. So really, I don't have to worry anymore. I can do everything that I want. It's always good to have support around you. So if you've got someone that's negative, then cut them out. Don't let that negativity be in there, because it will bring you down. And I find that if you've got people like that in your life, then they're going to rub off. So I find that moving forward, there's always a way around it. It's just a matter of trying to find out about it. Use a bit of humour. Humour's always good. And the third thing is put people around you that care about you and that don't see the disability. I built it because I want to ride, and simply built it purely because it's a good headspace and it provides that. So if I can give that to someone else, then I'm more than willing to help out in any way.
How good's that?
It's good,
pretty impressive. Actually, okay. James, I'm an Africa Twin rider, and James is actually quite famous in the Africa Twin circles because he's taken that dual clutch technology that Honda bought out and actually turned it into a big mobility scooter that it can take anywhere. So, interestingly enough, I mean, some fairly heavy modifications to that and some fabrication.
Well, obviously, James Powell is pretty clear what he's doing, obviously, with those drop down bars and stuff.
Yep. Do you ever get into that sort of stuff?
Oh, look. We've got a gentleman, his name's Mark, actually, and he's got one leg.
Right.
And he's come to us. He's a learner-approved rider, so he's only restricted on what he's actually doing.
Okay.
So he can't get on any more than, you know, 650cc, 500cc. Yep. So he's come to us, and we were clueless. Like, we just went, oh, gee, okay. But at the end of the day, after we did some research and found out, he's building a Street 500 with us, and we'll actually put the foot control up on the bar, similar to what.
Okay, righto.
To what
the way they're doing used to do it, have the dicky handy, had everything over one side.
Yeah. But look, it can be done. Yep. You know, there's a lot of modification in place to do it. But I think, you know, you've got people with needs like that obviously still want to have freedom and get out on a bike and enjoy themselves.
Riding,
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
and we've only just recently experienced that, and that's it. Probably 3 weeks ago he's come to us. So.
Yep. Good to know that people can actually get out and kind of, you know, overcome those obstacles that may normally stop people from doing that. So.
Yeah. Awesome.
Bob, where's Bob? We got any comments from anybody?
So many comments.
Legend, champion, awesome. A lot of people. Well, you can probably see it. I can't see it. Like, it would be rude if we had our phones here, right? You shouldn't have your phone when you're talking to people. At the dinner table, for example. But no, just so many great comments. He's a great guy and just really inspirational. So thanks for that. All right, we're going to take a break, are we?
Yeah, so don't go away. We're going to leave a wide shot up just to show you what happens behind the scenes. So we'll be back very shortly.
Awesome. We'll be right back. Well, here we are. Thanks for coming and joining us again. Guitars made out of motorbike bits.
That's right.
So we're here with Paul Tinson. Paul's come along to show us, you know, I can see cam chains and sprockets and flywheels and all sorts of things. Mate, tell us about, like, what's going on.
So I suppose the inspiration behind this comes from a passion of three things in my life. Obviously, music.
Yep.
Particularly heavy metal.
Okay.
And engineering.
Yes.
And my passion for motorbikes and motorcycle racing.
Okay, so they're all made out of motorbike bits?
Predominantly all motorcycle bits,
okay.
But there are some car bits, there's bits of motorboats, you know, the strings is from fencing wire from Bunnings.
Okay.
So there's lots of stuff.
That's fantastic. So what made you build a guitar? Like.
So those three inspirations of mine,
the
music, growing up in the 70s, I listened to Led Zeppelin,
yep.
Black Sabbath, AC/DC, Motorhead, and they inspired me to learn the guitar.
Okay.
So at the age of 11, I learned the guitar.
Okay.
And obviously that had a huge impact on my life.
Oh, I can pick up from your accent, you're not from here?
No, originally born in England, raised in Scotland.
Okay.
I've been here
for the years. New.
Yes, indeed. I married a Scots woman. So.
Okay, alright.
So yeah, the music was a big influence in obviously playing the guitar. Fortunately for the world, I never made it as a musician.
So can you play them? Like, are they?
No, you can't play
them.
There's no electronics in them at all. They're just purely a piece of art.
They look like they'd be filling.
You can. They weigh around about 35 kilograms.
Wow, okay.
So I wouldn't be running up on stage with them.
Bits of art.
Bits of art, yes.
Yeah.
Predominantly from an engineering perspective, because I love my engineering.
Yep.
I went to Glasgow University, did an aerospace engineering degree.
Okay.
That's where I got my first bike, actually. It was an FT 500,
okay.
Big single-cylinder beast.
Yep.
But that was my first bike, but it developed a bit of a petrol leak, so it was a bit of a health hazard, so
okay.
I had to get rid of that.
Right.
And then I progressed on to the Yamaha XJR 1300.
Yeah, nice.
And then I formed a business doing engineering, and that's where I learned to weld.
Yeah, here's some of your work now.
Yeah.
Video footage, it's really good.
So that's the kind of the engineering side of things.
Yep.
But my love of motorcycles was probably in the 90s.
Yeah.
We watched a lot of World Superbikes. And,
yep.
You know, when the likes of Carl Fogarty and Colin Edwards and, you know, your Aussies, your Troys, your Troy Corsi, your Troy Bayliss.
And they're still riding around today, too, actually.
And they're still riding around. Yeah, Troy Bayliss has made a comeback into the Australian Superbike.
Yeah,
he's doing
great.
It's fantastic. We were lucky enough to go down to Phillip Island this year and meet him.
Yeah.
And I've passed on my bug to my my youngest daughter,
so she
loves watching the motorcycle racing.
Awesome. So she's going to be a keen motorcyclist when she
grows up. Well, there's a lot more women in that sport, especially in the World Superbike Series. There's a World Supersport 300. So there's actually four women that I know in that series.
Yeah.
And the lady that's actually winning the championship at the moment is Anna Carrasco.
Yes, she's amazing.
So
isn't she?
She's absolutely fantastic. Brilliant role model for my daughter.
Yeah.
Especially in a male-dominated sport.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, it's great to see so many people getting involved.
Some shots of me there at Donington.
Yeah.
All the lads back in Scotland will be watching this. And there's some shots that I took of Troy Bayliss at the World Superbikes.
Obviously. Growing up and riding motorbikes around Europe would be fantastic because you've got all the circuits over there, and just you know, for us it's a mega trip to go over. But a lot of people do it. A lot of people head over.
A lot of people do. I was lucky enough to be half an hour away from Knockhill, which is my local circuit.
Right.
But then we travelled all the way down to the likes of Brands Hatch, which is 7 hours away down in London.
Yeah.
We went to Alton Park, Snetterton, Thruxton.
Okay, all the big ones.
All
obviously you've got the TT over there. That's a major pilgrimage for a lot of Aussies.
It is. We used to watch Carl Fogarty in that when he did the TT.
Yep.
Hence the link into the World Superbikes, and that's why we watched Superbikes.
Fantastic.
But now I'm a big Rossi fan.
Yeah.
I think everybody, most people are.
I don't know.
The artwork, I was lucky enough 2 years ago, my neighbour encouraged me to display it at the old schoolhouse gallery out of Cleveland.
Okay.
I don't know whether there's a gallery out there.
Yep.
Jenny Furlong was a big influence there from J Mark Art.
So are they for sale?
They are for sale, okay. Yeah. They're currently in an exhibition at Aspire Gallery over at Paddington.
Okay.
That runs until the 8th or 9th of September.
So if someone was interested in this and they wanted to get in contact, just get in touch with us
through Facebook or Instagram,
page?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep, so it's all online.
Okay.
So yeah, the parts are all from friends and family.
Right.
I've scrounged, begged and borrowed. some mental people on the way. Mark Cortez, who I know is watching at the minute, he's a main donor.
Right.
He gives me a lot of my parts.
Yeah, because he brake bikes a lot, doesn't he?
He breaks a lot of dirt bikes predominantly.
Right.
But he builds custom motorcycles as well.
Yeah, okay, cool.
And he rides them hard.
Yeah.
Awesome.
But the process of actually making them, I've got
a
prop here.
Yep.
Okay. So what you do is you get the paper template.
Yep.
You source that from Dr. Google. and then you transfer that onto
A bit of board, lay it all out.
A bit of NDF, and you lay it out. Yep. And then you just build it up from the base.
Yep.
You can see you start off with the chains as the predominant body shape.
And
the framework.
Yep.
And then obviously you build the fretboard and the headstock.
Sure.
And then it's just a matter of having the right bits placed in the right place.
Yeah.
It takes around about maybe 100 hours to do something like this Gibson here.
Yep.
Wow.
But the double neck, that took probably around about 200 hours to
do.
So it's a lot of man hours going into it.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's,
again, a passion for you, so
that's
great.
Yeah. Yeah.
Bob, do we have any questions about this?
Just answered how long they take to make. Yep. Another question was your Facebook page.
Facebook page is Tinsonology Art.
Yep.
Yeah. Excellent.
Someone and else
Instagram.
Has already posted that.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Cool. Thank you.
Awesome.
It's probably my wife.
And another post was for Kylie to be more involved.
The pressure.
Awesome. No, okay. Absolutely. They're right. Jump
great.
On in. Yeah.
Okay, well, we're coming back soon. We're just going to have a quick short break and have some more guests back with us.
Awesome. Thanks, mate. Well, back again. So, this is all going so smoothly. So we've got with us a couple of guests. So we've got Alan and Bridget, and they've actually written some books. And if any of you are on kind of almost any Facebook group, you will probably heard of this pair. They do a lot of riding around southeast Queensland, in fact, all over Queensland, Tasmania, and pretty much wherever they can. And you know, they take video, take pictures, and they've decided to write a book about it. So, Kylie, fire away.
Right, welcome.
Thank you.
Alan and Bridget.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much for having us.
It's really good to see you. So I suppose we're going to talk about your first book, which is this one here. This is Southeast Queensland and Northern New South Wales, the 21 Great Rides.
Yes.
Now, can you tell us a little bit about the book and why you decided to write it?
Yeah, basically we were on a weekend away and just had the bright idea of sharing all our favourite rides that we do around Southeast Queensland and Northern New South Wales with other riders, and we thought, let's do a book. So we did.
I know, it's fabulous. I love it.
Thank you.
All right, so a little bit about yourselves. So obviously you're the rider. And Bridget, you're the pillion with the great photography and the video footage that you do. So what made you choose the BMW GS1200, which, by the way, my husband thinks is the best bike ever?
So, I guess for me it was the versatility of it. So I'd always admired them, came up here from South Australia, brought the bike up with me, ended up staying for work. Bridget and I met, and it just fulfills everything that you want to do. So we do a lot of off-road riding, we do on-road riding, we go camping.
Yeah.
It takes all our gear, you know, just does it so well. So
it just rides itself, basically. Yep. BMW.
And I can say, as a pillion, oh my god, it's just the best. It's so comfortable.
I've been on the back of our one, and it is very comfortable, I have to say. You could just about fall asleep.
Shush.
Okay, you've done that.
When Bridget's not taking the photos, I get the dunk, dunk, dunk.
That's hilarious. All right, so now, this book, I know you said you do a lot of on-road and off-road, so is it suitable for, both style of riders and bikes? Because,
definitely for SEQ, like the 21 rides, there's about three rides in there where there is a little bit of dirt. The back of Mount Mort is probably the longest one in that one, which has about 30 kilometres of dirt.
Yeah.
Most of them are fully tarred.
Road, And I mean, I suppose you can go through and, choose the ones that are all road anyway, list them in here. You don't
have
to. And
we've got a couple options in those where, it's optional to take the dirt track if you want to take it, so.
Yeah, okay, good. Oh, that's really good. And I love at the back of this book, it has different accommodation around the place. So, that's really cool because when I actually looked at it, I was thinking, this is perfect because you can go and stay at all these wonderful places while going on your rides.
Yeah, and that was one of the things that we thought about when we put together the book, because we like to get away for a weekend, and we know people love to go camping, or they want to do something a little bit special for the weekend. Anniversary, happy anniversary.
So romantic being here tonight.
So, so the places to stay, we included that for that reason. And also, if I can just encourage everyone, we've got our farmers are doing tougher at the moment, so if you can get out there for the weekend and stay somewhere for the weekend and spend your money in the local towns, please do. It's the most enjoyable way that you can give them a bit of a hand at the moment.
Motorcyclists are a key kind of source of income for a lot of those outback pubs, aren't they?
Big
riders in the road right now.
I think that's one thing that we as motorcyclists do so well. We don't get in a car and go 800 kilometres without stopping. We're going to stop for fuel. So,
well, you're a BMW rider, so you're going to stop for coffee a lot too. Coffee lattes.
So we were just we just had a bit of footage up then, and I think that was Queen Mary Falls. If you haven't done Queen Mary Falls, I highly recommend it. It is an awesome, fun ride. Yeah,
It's one of my faves.
Yeah,
Queen Mary Falls.
I have to say, I think it's one of my favourites. It's good. So this one,
that's
Belthorpe Range.
So another cracking ride.
I haven't actually done that one. So where is that exactly?
It's up the north side, Kylie, a bit far from the Gold Coast.
Yeah, I'm Gold Coast. So I will get up there though.
So if you're heading sort of from Woodford up to Sunshine Coast, that's a great little back way to do it.
That's really.
And drop down through Postman's Track, brings you out at Conondale, just another.
Okay, I think Matt and my husband and all have done that.
Have a look at some accommodation options up that way and ride your bikes up.
Yes, I might just do that. and then we've got, this one's Obi Obi Road, is that right?
Yep.
Or no, Ocean View.
This is just a little one out the back of Jabra.
So many people do like the Mount Me to go and the Mount Mayer track, but yeah, they miss out on Ocean View.
Yeah. And it's clearly
and
designed, isn't it?
That climbs up, and then you just overlook both sides of the valley. It's just a cracking ride as well.
Yeah, right. It's just a little detour that's just magic.
And people always miss it because...
Yeah.
Well, I don't know that one, but yes.
I mean, Mount Mee's the favourite.
Yeah.
Love Mount Mee.
You sort of see
obviously.
Mount Mee like snaking down below when you get to the top of Ocean View. Okay. It's quite spectacular.
That's probably one of the good things about the book is it'll actually show people roads that they may not necessarily be aware of.
Yeah.
And they can actually... Because, you know, you go for a ride up, you leave Daybra and you start heading up the hill and it's very easy just to, you know...
Keep going up and
get into it and enjoy the ride.
Yeah.
But if you actually follow some of the directions in that, you can actually find some really cool roads that aren't what most people would consider
to be mainstream known. Ones,
We sort of set out, you know, not to do the same thing that you do all the time. And it's like, and we explore so much as in just point and go. So
What's this one? Strathbourne? Oh, no, Obi-Obi. Where are we up to?
That's Obi-Obi.
Yeah, okay.
So it's kind of Kenilworth here and up. Obi-Obi show next Sunday,
so hope to see many people out there.
Okay.
So you'll be at the show?
We will be at the show.
Yep, we'll be at the show, and if you want to pick up a couple of books, we'll be there. So,
that's good.
You'll actually see in this ride, we'll pass the hall, the Obi-Obi Hall, which is a great, it's a venue for the show, and coming up to it soon, Green Roof.
Yeah, that just
awesome
has a
show.
Story to itself as well because it was going to be burnt down. They were going to use it as fire practice and then a whole group of people got together and said, no, we're going to restore it. Okay. And they've done an amazing job. So this is coming into Strathgordon.
This is Tasmania.
Okay, so now we've moved over to Tasmania book. Yeah. This is the second book that's just been released.
Yes.
So these are some fabulous roads.
This is going right into the heart of Tassie wilderness.
Yeah. It's
just
magic. Just when you don't think it gets any better, you just come around another corner.
Yeah.
And it just takes your breath away.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
It's
awesome.
Yeah, everyone talks about Tasmania. So, this is the Tasmania book, everyone.
So we've got 16 rides in the Tassie book, so all around the state. And we've got the accommodation section in the back as well.
Yeah.
So just on a technology question, let's say, for example, you're a BMW rider.
Yes.
Can you just slot the book in and it automatically downloads everything and puts it into the GPS?
Not quite, but we do have like scan codes in the book that you can scan the routes into Google Maps.
Okay, so you've actually got some QR codes in the book.
Yeah.
And the QR codes then load up a map onto Google Maps. Or you can actually download some GPX files.
And then... when people order online, or there's a little card in if they buy from one of our stockers, they can send to us to get the GPX files.
Awesome.
Okay. We send them out, they upload them into the nav device or into your smartphone app. So.
Awesome. Okay. Fantastic. Really, really good. I actually like that QR code idea. It's a terrific one.
It's so easy.
So we've also put into the Tassie book, we've got some video snippets to give people a bit of a... understanding or an idea
Again,
of
through
what
a, QR
a
code?
Ride through a QR code.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
So it works quite well.
Is this St. Mary's Pass?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Another
Tassie's.
So that's on the east coast of Tassie as you're heading from Scamander up to St. Mary's and then down through Elephant Pass.
Elephant Pass, I was going to say.
Yeah. And just another amazing Tasmanian road.
It brought you down on that east coast drive down through Bishano.
That's the one.
So how long did you stay in Tassie when you were there? Like, how long would you suggest for people to...
The 16 rides that we've got in the book, if you were... They do a lap around the island either clockwise or anti-clockwise.
Okay. Yep.
And then there's also a number of rides that go out, say, from Hobart. We've got 5 rides that go out there to different places.
Yeah.
I think if you wanted to do, like, a really good tour of Tassie, you'd probably want 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And that's not without
the transit down and back either.
No.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Did you ship your bike down or did you ride down?
No, we rode down in October. We were away for 24 days. Yep. We did 5 states, 10 days in Tassie, got the ferry, which to me is part of the whole romantic thing of riding down and getting
as
the ferry.
As long as it's not too bad, the that straight can be a little awkward.
It can be a little bit
I'm ex-Navy, so
sort of used to it. The thing is that it's such a great ride to get there as well, though, isn't it? If you've got an all-roads bike, there's so many great roads you can link up.
4 days to go down and we went inland and went through Tamworth, through Warrumbungle, Dubbo.
Nice.
It was just amazing.
Fantastic. Yep. And look, you could do a map for each state, couldn't you? You could do a book for each state. Yeah, I mean, there's so much riding.
We've been hit up already to do one on Victoria's.
Oh, yeah, okay. There are some great roads, you know, just there, through Victoria.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, definitely. Oh, excellent. Is that all of the... Yeah, that's all the roads we've got. Oh, no, here we've got one
coming
more.
Down from Mount Wellington.
This is amazing. Mount Wellington is the mountain that's directly behind Hobart. Yep. So if you're in Hobart, you're looking up at the mountain behind. Yep. So this is going up.
And it can be 10 degrees cooler up there too, can't it?
It was 18 degrees down in Hobart. Yep. It was 4 degrees at
four
the top.
Degrees at the top.
And when we went down in April, we were down there, and there was a misty rain that came over, and we were just on the dock front. That cleared, and it was full of snow. Yeah. And that was in April.
Yeah. It can snow at Christmas down there. Yeah. It's don't make it crazy.
It's a quick little ride. Like, it's literally a 20-minute ride, and it's just magic. It's
I mean, beautiful. Without doing a promo for Tasmania, they love motorbikes down there, don't they?
Yeah.
And all the shops and all the roads. Yes. And, like, the roads are so good. They've just been designed and, I reckon, and maintained by motorbike riders. They're in such
good condition.
Yeah,
definitely.
A lot of people say, you know, Tasmania, the roads are, you know, very awkward to ride and everything. But I think if you can do, like, Queen Mary's Fall Loop, or you can do Obie Loop, you can do Tasmania. No problems whatsoever. It's a great place to ride.
Yeah.
Bob, how are we going? Got any feedback from anyone?
Lots of feedback. So one question was about if there's ever going to be an app. So it obviously links in with the QR
code.
Not
yet. We've thought about an app. It's definitely sort of in the pipeline, but not just yet.
Yep. And others are asking for a link to purchase the books.
Yep. Yes, I was going to ask that.
Yeah, so you can just jump onto our website. So it's just throwyourlegover.com.au. And we have, you can order online through us, or we have stockers all around. We've got about 18 stockers in Queensland. We've got a couple of stockers in Tassie and Victoria now.
New South Wales.
So if you want to go for a ride and pick up a bike, head to a stockist or just jump on our website and we can send you one out.
Yeah,
and you sell them at BMW dealerships too, do
you? We do.
Actually, we do. Morgan and Wacker.
Okay. So you go down and grab your coffee while you get your bike service.
You were mentioning the rides in Tasmania. Tali Burnett said, I nearly married my ex up there.
There's a story there.
And there was one other shout out from Warra, the Women's Adventure Riders Australia.
Okay. Oh,
so
yes,
Joe.
Yep. Joe.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
Good, hey, Joe.
Cool. Yeah, she's awesome.
We'll be talking to you soon, don't worry.
Yeah, we will.
Wonderful.
Awesome. Well, I think we're going to have a break and we'll see you back here soon.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks so much.
Thanks so much.
Okay, well, we're back. Thanks for staying with us. I had a couple of technical issues, but we're good. So we're actually downstairs. The studio we were a minute ago is upstairs, so you come downstairs from Smoked Garage and into the workshop, and I'm here with Vince. Vince is kind of head fabricator, workshop foreman around here. We're just going to have a little bit of a chat about some of the bikes that they do and the process that they go through. And for me, let's say I've got a bike, and I'm kind of going, you know, I wouldn't mind customising this a little bit. What's the process that we would go through?
The process is usually you touch base with Ben upstairs, and he'll run you through. You tell him your ideas, what bike you want.
Okay.
He'll run you through colours, exhaust,
concepts
and all the bits and pieces. He'll put that together, then come and see me, and I'll go through it and tell him if
how it can be done,
what has to be done to build it to that stage.
Right,
that stage.
Sure.
So I have the final little decision on how it's built.
Yep.
All got to be under safe, you know, it's all got to be safe.
Oh, obviously.
Yeah, and then Ben takes that back to the customer, and then Ben executes on that.
Okay,
then,
all right. So is there a bike you won't do?
No.
No?
We'll do anything.
Okay,
yeah,
awesome.
Anything.
All right, so like if someone comes to you, what you're saying is I've got to have a clear picture in my mind of the sort of thing that I want to do. Like there's scramblers and trackers and cafe races and street fighters and all that sort of stuff. So
I've got
to have a bit of a rough idea.
Yeah, you got to have a bit of a rough idea of what you want. Then we can work with you and put something together. We can show you ideas and bits and pieces.
Does the type of bike influence the final outcome?
Look, I've turned dirt bikes into bobbers.
Okay.
Like anything can be done.
Okay, all right. Because you see some kind of Japanese bikes that are made to look like choppers and that sort of stuff around the place.
And
anything.
Anything can be done.
Okay.
Mate, I don't discriminate. We build anything a customer wants, I'll build it.
As long as they've got the money.
Yeah, that's it. If they're happy and that's what they want, I'll build it.
Okay. So are there any particular projects you're working on at the moment? Like you've got a nice selection of bikes in the
We've got a few. We've got the Triumph, BMW, Honda.
This one's particularly interesting with the cantilever front suspension.
Yes, that's going naked on the front.
Wow, okay, so that's pretty flash.
I got Andy, the other fabricator, fabricating the tail on it.
Let's move over here. Actually, can we just get some shots of the front end of this? Because not a lot of people would have seen the naked BMW front end on that. Look at that massive front end, the oil cooler sticking out on the front. Are you going to leave all that there, or what's the customer want to do with
oil cooler will be
relocated.
Separate headlights, a lot of fairing work, custom fairing work around there.
So you do carbon fibre, or how do you get by the whole plastic stuff?
That'll be all hand-formed aluminium and then glassed in. And,
all right.
Yeah.
Okay. That's quite a lot of work. So the hand fabrication is, like some of the stuff you've got upstairs is pretty flash.
It's time extensive.
Sure. Absolutely. Okay. All right. And then obviously when they leave, as you said, they're all got to be street registered, street legal, unless they're just going to use it as just a showpiece
or a
non-ride bike.
That's correct.
Okay. Is there like a particular aspect of it that you find really interesting, like you really look forward to doing?
Mate, I like modifying anything.
Yeah?
It's the modification side of it that I like. I like chopping and changing.
So someone comes to you with a brand new bike, isn't it? Or a bike in a box, just bits and pieces.
Yeah, we've done that.
And you can do a full resto on those?
Yep.
Do you do restos to original?
We've done a couple in the past.
Okay.
We tend not to go that way because it is very costly, time consuming, and there's a lot of work involved.
And it's
hard to justify the hours in it and then try to charge a customer for it.
Yeah,
so you always lose out
when the finished product's only going to be worth a couple of thousand, but you've actually spent way more than that just to get back to that.
That's it.
Now, I'm asking Vincey's questions without, any background at all, so he's doing a great job and just ad-libbing, which is fantastic, mate. Thanks. Is there a particular, and I asked Shane the same question, is there a particular project you really enjoyed doing, like you're really proud of?
I like building every bike.
Yeah.
Every one that I've done, I've liked.
They're special.
Yeah, I always put my little touch on them somewhere.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. Awesome. That's fantastic. So this one here is obviously a new bike. This is someone's gone out and they've...
this is a new Honda Rebel.
Yep.
It just came in for a quick little tail, clip-ons, couple of little minor modifications.
Okay.
Nothing extensive.
All right. So just, in and out in a couple of weeks?
That's right.
Okay. Okay, cool.
Exactly.
Yep. But again, no bike, scooter, like someone brings a scooter.
No, we'll do a scooter.
Really? Okay, all right.
We'll do anything.
Yeah, yeah, there you go. That's it.
If it's got a motor in it,
yep,
it's doable.
And look, obviously, you know, this one here is getting some work done as well,
yes,
being shortened. The Indians are really nice, aren't they? They've got this, you know, fantastic engine in them, and it just... That's a showpiece.
Yeah, they got the heritage.
Yep.
Yeah, this is actually a new bike.
Okay, brand new bike.
Yeah, it's new.
Okay.
Which I'm, yeah, customer bought it. It's in. It's getting modified.
Okay. So what's happening?
Different seat. Made the sissy bar on the rear.
Yep.
Wire rolled the guard. Shortened it.
Yep.
Shortened the front guard. Reswaged all the line work into the guard.
Okay.
Wire rolled it.
Yep.
We put chrome wheels on it. Custom exhaust, different bars.
Okay, and you take care of all the engineering certification?
Yes.
All that sort of stuff gets done, so the bike is completely legal.
See, the guards and that's all up to standards.
Yep. Fantastic, that is terrific. And there's a custom paint shop here as well?
Yes, we do a bit of paint work here.
Yep.
We do get all the finicky, hard airbrush work gets done by
an artist, yeah.
Yes, by an artist.
Okay. No, that's awesome. So we've got something that...
Yep, we got...
Magic of television, we prepared earlier.
We've got Antonio from Custom Corner.
Yeah.
To actually paint you up a helmet.
Awesome, that is fantastic.
Here's our custom airbrusher.
Actually, I can just see all the the fleck in there.
I don't know if you can see, it's been shadowed in.
Yep.
It's got ghost flames and iRide in
it. Yeah, that's fantastic. We just... Can you pick that up? I don't know whether or not it's a bit difficult. It's got that ghost riding iRide on it. Well, there we go. That's the logo. Custom Corner does all that. It's fantastic. Vince, thanks very much, mate. That's fantastic.
Problem,
appreciate you showing us around your workshop, and good luck with your builds. That's awesome.
Too easy.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Hi, and welcome back, everyone. And wasn't that amazing, that triumph? What a sound. I hope you all enjoyed that.
Now, we're back here and I have with me my two awesome friends, Liz and Kelly. Welcome. So we met through motorbike riding, obviously, and through Kaiser Motorbikes. So we've known each other for a really long time. But Liz, I just wanted to ask you a couple of questions. What got you into riding, and how many years have you been riding?
So what got me into riding? She's laughing already because I have actually tried to think of a really good answer to that, but I have to stick with the truth I've been told. So the truth is that I was married for 20 years and my husband always wanted me to learn to ride and I never got around to it. So when I got divorced, I went out and learned to ride. Just to give him the shits. And I literally really planned to learn to ride. So, okay, I've done that, put it in a bow, sent it off, and I fell in love with it in the process. So I'm still riding.
Yeah.
And I'll probably still give him in the shits.
Probably. So you've travelled many countries,
yep.
And lots of different bike tours. Mm-hmm. Yep. Can you tell us one of your adventures that you've done overseas?
Yeah, I've done four. The first time I went for 15 week days in six countries through the Alps. Then we went back and rode in the Dolomites,
yes.
Which was our favourite part of that one. But my absolute favourite one was the Morocco. And
yeah.
Morocco was a surprise because we were looking for somewhere to ride to match up to go to the Isle of Man. We've been to the Isle of Man to watch TT. This will be my third time next time. And it just was there. So I thought, oh, give that a shot. It'll be something different. And it was absolutely just, it was so much fun. It really was so much fun.
I remember all the photos. Yes.
And you know, I don't go even in a gravel car park.
Yeah.
And I was riding on gravel roads and through mud and, mud off the eyelashes. And there was three, that we went across with a group of eight of us and there were three women in the riding. And that surprised the Moroccans. Every time we pulled our helmets off, we all had blonde hair and eyelash extensions and covered in mud.
Yeah,
and it was just fun.
Yeah.
It was a lot of fun. It was the best one. And then I've been back and I rode the Pyrenees as well.
Yeah, I know. You've done some amazing trips. So what bike have you got, Liz?
I've got a Kawasaki Ninja 1000.
Yeah.
Green. Right. Just need to show that beautiful green.
Yeah. Liz loves green, by the way.
I do like green.
All right, so Kelly, same with you. You've been riding for many years as well.
Yeah, about 10 years now.
Yeah, and you started off riding in the UK, though, where you're from.
Yeah, I did. I always fancied learning to ride, but as it took me four attempts to pass my driving test, and I crashed every vehicle I ever owned, apart from the two that I've got in Australia now, I always thought I would just be killed if I learned to ride a motorbike. I was like, I'll just stay in a car, at least I've got a big metal box around me then. And then a family friend became an instructor and was obviously touting for business, and he wanted my 250 quid and he talked me into doing my CBT, which is like your basic rider's training in the UK. And before I did my CBT, I went out and bought all the gear. So I spent £1,000 and I got all like the best leathers, the best helmet, all the rest of the gear. And then I did the CBT and I was terrified. I didn't know how to do anything. I'd never ridden a bike. I had no idea how to do the clutch, doing things with my hands, my feet at the same time. And after I did the CBT, I was like, I have to make this work because I've spent £1,000 on all this kit now and I need to do something with it. And then I did some lessons and just fell in love with it. Loved it. I loved it. Absolutely loved it ever since and wished I'd done it years before. Made me a better car driver. Actually, I've had one accident since then.
And you can actually see there's some photos up now of us on group rides and different charity events that we have done together. And these two wonderful girls helped me on those charity rides. But there's also just our normal rides where we go out riding here as well. And so, Kelly, your bike that you've got is a...
It's a Kawasaki Z750, just like your own, Kylie.
Me.
A blue one.
I know. And Kel and I love riding together because, you know, we've got the same bike. And yeah, it's pretty cool.
It's an awesome bike. It's such a fun bike to ride. I commute on it. You can do weekends away on it, do track days on it, just go for Sunday buzzes around, like just go for a coffee on it. Like it's just, it's just an awesome bike. Like I love it.
It is, I love it too.
It's really cool.
And there's, some pictures of us at track days now at the moment. We've both got our Kawasakis there on that track day. That was the Kawasaki track day that we did.
Oh, yeah.
That was so much fun. I think that's you.
That's me. Yeah,
oh, yeah,
that's
you.
Me.
There's Kelly coming in from Lakeside.
Yeah.
That's an awesome photo.
Because it's the ladies' track day again in October. So,
and we're definitely going to be there.
That's
and we'll
awesome.
Both be riding our Zeds.
Yes, definitely.
This is another one of us. Oh, this was the Babes Raid weekend away. On that's us charity event.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah. And there's you, Liz.
That's my beautiful green bike.
Yeah, some great photos mm-hmm. there.
Oh, yeah.
That was at a rider training one, wasn't
it?
Yeah,
it was.
Yeah. Yeah, so we've been on lots of different adventures, the three of us a lot, but our group, you know, Kaiser Motorbikes, we go out a lot and have a lot of fun, actually. So, yeah, that's about it. I just wanted to make mention quickly also that there's, other than Kaiser Motorbikes, there's several groups, you know, that we have around Brisbane, actually around Australia, there's a lot. But the main ones I wanted to mention, there's a huge one called East Coast Female Riders in Brisbane, and they've got thousands of members in their group.
1,200
which is amazing. And if you ever want to go into that group, just search them on Facebook. There's also Women on Motorbikes in New South Wales. They're just in northern New South Wales. They're an amazing group as well. There's Girl Talk on the Sunshine Coast, and there's also a big group called the Southeast Queensland Motorcycle Riders. They are, from Bundaberg to Brisbane, I think, and that's for all types of riders, so, you know, male, female, if you're a Pillion, whatever, any sort of riders. So there's over 8,000 in that group. So if you're looking for some great groups out there, just search on Facebook. There's so many, and it's a lot of fun.
It's a lot. Yeah, it's a lot of fun riding groups, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, we've been riding together for like 8 years.
8 years. Yeah. It was 2 weeks before you got married.
That's right.
So 8 years. I know that.
At least you can remember. So
I did ask.
Yeah. and yeah, Kelly, when you moved over to the UK, you just searched Girls Motorbike Group and found us.
Well, I was a member of a girls bike group back in the UK,
We
set up our own as well, called Lippy Ladies, and to the best of my knowledge, they're still active. Like, we set it up as a group of 12 of us, and within a year, I think we had 60 paid up members of just like mentioning to other people, we do this and we go out. And my sister, who doesn't ride, actually wanted to join us because we did so many other things, like in the down season in winter, we'd go out and we'd have like trips away and activities out, and she's like, I want to join your bike group. I'm not interested in bikes, but I want to join the bike group.
Just to have the social fun.
Just do everything. So when I moved to Australia and I wanted to get back into biking again, and I just thought, what would I do if an Aussie came to the UK and said, look, you know, I want to get into biking, I'd put them in touch with our bike group, because there'd always be some woman who would take them under their arm into the wing and say, look, I'll sort you out. And I think I just messaged you, Kylie, and said, look, I haven't got my bike yet. And you said, oh, we're meeting just down the road. Come and meet us. So I came down, like, talked to a few people and just started that way. So that when I did finally buy my bike, I had a group to ride out with straight away.
Yeah.
And through that met other people and did the track days and stuff like that. And it's a brilliant way to meet other people.
And we've got some long-term friends as well. Met a lot of good friends out bike riding. Well, we're going to have a quick break. And, we're just going to mention some upcoming rides, first of all. So, in New South Wales, we've got Ladies Bike Night on the 6th of September at the Coffs City Moto in Coffs Harbour. And 22nd, we've got Wings for Kids Charity Ride at the Penrith Motorcycle Centre. And in Tasmania, we've got Convicts to Classics Walmers Estate, Longford, on the 16th of September. And then in Victoria, we've got Pink Ribbon Breakfast and Ride, 7th October. And then South Australia, there's two there, Ride Against Suicide, Royal Adelaide Show on the 9th of September. And then we've got Big Drought Cruise, which is actually for bikes and cars, and that's on the 16th of September. Queensland, and we've got quite a few in Queensland, so the Bikers for Farmers, I think, is a really, really popular and good one that we should be supporting on the 15th of September. It's at Kingaroy Showgrounds, and then the Ride for Cancer on the 30th of September. Now, that's starting at Team Moto in Nerang, and Kaiser will be helping out with that one. We've also got a Ride to Tenterfield by the Southeast Queensland Motorcycle Riders, and the Distinguished Gentleman's Ride on the 30th of September, and that is at Oliver's Motorcycles in Maruka. And the Ride to Tenterfield, is on the 23rd of September. If you want to find out more about that one, just go onto their Facebook page or to their meetup site and ask to join. That's about it. You're wearing there, Steve. I can turn it over.
Thanks, Kylie. Hey, Bob, how are we going? Are we getting any feedback from...
So many positive comments about the girls.
Awesome.
Yeah. And people asking, Kelly must have done a trip to the Himalayas. So I have to get her back next time to talk about that.
Yes, we were going to touch base on that and we didn't get around to it.
Well, the show's been going on for a bit and we've got another guest to go. And so what we're going to do is we're going to have a quick break and bring in our last guest for the evening, who is Chris. And Chris is the president of the Queensland branch of the Motorcycle Riders Association. This is going to be really interesting, so hang around. Hey, well, welcome back, and last segment for the night, so thanks for hanging in with us. It's been a long night. Don't forget that you can go and watch the entire thing. If you've had to go off and, you know, make yourself a cup of tea or something, you can actually watch the whole thing again through live on Facebook here, or even go to the YouTube channel as well, so that it will be uploading it there over the next couple of days. We've got in the studio with us tonight, we've got Chris from the Motorcycle Riders Association. As I said, he's the president of the Queensland branch of the Motorcycle Riders Association. We first met a couple of weeks ago and we had a bit of a chat about some of the legislative things that are coming and some of the stuff that's happening with electric motorbikes and the whole heap of stuff that we've got to try and cover. We're aware of the fact we're kind of running a little bit long, but just tell us a little bit about the history of the MRA and what you're doing for riders in Queensland particularly.
Thanks for inviting me along tonight, Steve. It's good to be here to represent the Motorcycle Riders Associations of Australia wide. Our role is, and has been for now 30 to 40 years, to represent the rights and interests of motorcyclists, particularly with at various levels of government. All of those nasty things like road rules and vehicle standards and various other legislative instruments that come into play when we build motorcycles, ride motorcycles, go out on the road, think of motorcycle safety, all of those things that we attempt to represent the interests, the best interests of motorcyclists.
Of the riders themselves, which is good to have a kind of an advocacy group for it. We were talking the other day about some of the changes that are happening in terms of filtering. Now, I know everybody out there that rides motorbikes is completely compliant with the regulations when it comes to lane filtering, but there's some difficulties when you come to areas that are multi-speed zones.
Well, the filtering is an interesting thing. It's been introduced across all states of Australia in the last 4 years.
Yep.
New South Wales was the first, Queensland was the second, and then the other states dominate on behind. Unfortunately, like most things government influenced, Australia is not prone to run the same in every state.
No, that's right. Mm.
We have a bad attitude of we're going to do it our way and bugger the rest of you.
Well, look, even that off topic, but even have a look at our rail system. You know, it took them a couple hundred years just to get the one gauge.
Decide we might run a train across the border.
Crazy.
So in Queensland, there was a specific addition that went on top of the standard lane filtering scenario, and that was that we are the only state that's allowed to lane filter on what's called the edge filtering.
Yep.
Now, what the government and the powers to be attempted to do when they introduced that part for Queensland was to qualify which roads are most likely to be allowed to edge filter on.
Right.
So, and those roads, of course, have got to have a substantial verge, breakdown lane, whatever else. Yes. So the government looked at it and said, well, we'll describe it this way. It's most likely that a road that is over 90 kilometres an hour will have some sort of verge.
Like the
M1. Like the M1, yep. The gateway, the gateway, all of those roads.
All those, yeah.
So they specified that it's legal to edge filter in Queensland on a road, and here's the word, posted at 90 kilometres an hour or above.
Right.
Unfortunately, I'm not 100% sure that they realised that we have now a growing number of roads that have variable speed signage on them.
Like the Gateway Arterial.
Like the Gateway Arterial. They're now talking about putting it on the M1 also, so that they can alter the speed at any time to modulate, attempt to control traffic flow and whatever else.
But what you're saying is that when they drop it down under 90 k's, you can't go out on the verge anymore.
Well, and the ridiculous part of this, of course, is that's exactly the time that you should.
Absolutely.
You do want to filter.
Like if they drop the speed down under 90, it's because traffic's congested, right?
The most regular reason to drop the speed limit is congestion.
Yep.
What do we want to do when there's congestion? Yeah, we want to filter.
Yep.
It's a lot safer if there's a decent verge to filter on the verge.
Absolutely.
We can talk about rubbish on the verge, but
sure,
that's something different.
Yeah.
As far as view, the site, the area available, the lack of two trucks, one truck each side.
Well, I was going to say, particularly in some of those areas where there's a lot of heavy vehicle traffic, you're not going to want to be sliding up the inside of...
In Queensland, it's not. It is permissible to overtake and filter past heavy vehicles. Some of the other states don't allow it. But personally, I'm not prone to want to go up between 240-foot trucks. There's no guarantee that they've seen you.
Yep.
It's a lot safer out on the verge. We put the argument to the government. Your wording, your single wording of posted is wrong.
Yeah.
You need to take away the posted and make it gazetted or normal speed limit.
Okay.
In other words, if the road is normally a 90 or above,
right,
irrespective of whether the speed signage drops, you still are allowed to edge filter.
So you went to the government and you told them
went
this.
To the government with that. We went to the government with that not long after the filtering was introduced and pointed out the mistake that has been made. It has taken obviously a number of years. I've just as I described to you, it's like watching paint dry sometimes with government action. But this year we had a final upfront meeting with the minister, and some of the chiefs from the department. We got the okay. That change is going into the next rewrite of the Queensland Road Rules, should be this month.
Oh, okay, cool.
Excellent.
So
people
shouldn't do it until such time as the law actually changes.
I've never seen anyone do that.
No.
Never.
So those are the things that we're actively involved in. I also noticed that here tonight you have a selection of helmets.
Yep.
For 10 years plus, this one really was a paint drying exercise. All the major lobbying bodies have been or were pushing to get away from the monopoly of the Australian standard only on Australian helmets.
Yeah.
Simply because other standards in the worldwide standards were, in various parts, better than the Australian standard.
Sure.
Particularly with the European standard, which is what we concentrated on getting in and did get 4 years ago now. They don't concentrate on a penetration test for the helmets.
Right.
They concentrate on its impact protection.
Yep.
Therefore, the helmets are a lot lighter.
Right.
In using a lot lighter helmet, you also reduce the amount of potential for rotational spinal damage.
Also fatigue and all sorts of stuff.
Fatigue and everything else.
So,
definitely. I have a really light helmet and I love it.
The European standard is a far lighter helmet, generally, than an Australian helmet. And equally as safe.
And a lot cheaper too. We found that a lot of the helmets coming out in the market.
And a lot more innovation in the ECE helmets. The internal visors, you didn't see any of them while we had the Australian standard going. Yep. A lot of those out in the marketplace now. And there's actually one helmet that just recently put out, this carbon fibre. It's so light, apparently, that people don't even know that they're using it. I've done that before on the way to work. I've done the road. Hang on, there's something missing here.
Let me just throw it to Bob. Are we getting any questions, Bob? Because I'm waiting for someone to ask a question about can you put a camera on your helmet?
No, not that. It was a happy anniversary to Kylie. And a question for you, Steve, is whether you're married.
What's his name? Ring-a-ding-ding, yeah, absolutely. Thanks for that. No, completely off topic, sorry, mate. So my understanding in terms of you see a lot of people with traffic cameras or dash cams in their cars, and a lot of people now putting them on their motorbikes, on their helmets, that sort of stuff. My understanding is that if the camera is stuck on with an adhesive, it's legal. If it's screwed on, it's not.
It's a grey area.
It's a grey area.
It's still a grey area.
And is that a roadside determined regulation?
It depends on which state you're in.
Right.
In Australia, it has now modulated down considerably since the European standard was introduced.
Right.
But before that, Victoria and sometimes New South Wales would run strictly to the letter of the law, and that was that the Australian standard said that you were not allowed to make any alteration to your helmet except those things that the manufacturer offered.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
like
you could
visors and things like that.
Yeah. Yep. You could not under the way the law was written, you couldn't fit anything to the helmet.
Yeah.
Queensland is the one state that's probably best looked at this and said, let's not just be stupid about it. Obviously, if you go drilling a hole in the helmet, that's damaged the helmet, so it's no good.
But well, I suppose if you're thinking that you could drill a hole in the helmet, you probably shouldn't really be wearing one.
yeah, you'd be surprised how many people wear that.
Absolutely. Look, just quickly, we just want to talk a little bit about some of the rumours. Now, you said something when we met about electric bikes and some of the thinking behind the push for more electric bikes?
Well, we're never going to change progress. And with electric cars, that's the push for the future. Electric bikes are going to follow.
Sure.
The interesting part is that in particularly in Europe now, there is laws starting to be introduced that prevent motorcycles over a particular age being used in the inner metro areas because of the emissions that they put off.
Sure.
Motorcycles are not overly efficient, I must admit, when you look at the power to weight.
Yep.
France and in Paris, they have now banned motorcycles, I think, over from 2000 onwards, and it progressively follows as the time goes on.
In the CBD area.
Yeah, so there will be a continuum, more and more of a push for electric motorcycles. Yep. It's the same as ABS and those sort of things. They tend to end up being driven by legislation.
Yeah.
The European standards is what Australia tends to pick up on.
Yep.
And as they push various things out and replace them with others, then that's what will follow here.
And I suppose from the perspective of the MRA, you'll be watching a lot of those changes and the impact they have on the motorbike riders.
We're interested to watch. We're particularly interested at the minute on this autonomous vehicle scenario and making sure that
it's motorcycle
it's friendly. It's been proved to be maybe not pedestrian friendly at the minute.
Yep.
So we want to make sure that motorcycles are picked up on it. It's still got a ways to go. We understand that.
Yep.
There's various technologies around. There is even situations where they've been wanting to test add-on to older vehicles, just to make them more sensory to the autonomous vehicles, so they can pick them up.
And we were also talking the other day about that push was really just for electric bikes into just certain areas, though. So it's not like I'm an adventure rider. It's a bit hard to get a charge kind of when you're out back of Burke, literally. So they're really just going to be focusing on CBD areas?
There's a lot of infrastructure yet to go along with that. And obviously, they won't hit the market until such time as people are convinced that they can use them in the.
Like I've seen your bike, it's not as loud as some of the Harleys that are out there, but it's good.
Just because I don't like fines.
Absolutely, I think the magic of motorcycles is part of that noise, isn't
it? It is.
But is that just the old guys? Is that just us fellas that have been
I don't think so. I look around here and I know quite a new number of young guys will be buying these vehicles, and I don't see too many of them with the standard mufflers on them.
Right. So it'll be a while before motorcycles are taken on as a mainstream or electric motorcycle.
Somebody might come along with a tape deck on the electric bike with fake noise.
Yeah. Fake noise, yeah, great. Okay, so is there anything that's coming up that the MRA is aware of, and obviously just aware of the time, but is there anything that the MRA is currently working on that...
We're continually working on various items. We and all the other organisations get involved in safety committees with the government, licensing. Just recently, Tasmania, Victoria, Queensland, New South Wales just about to... South Australia is talking about a change in the licensing system for motorcycles. Okay. We actively get involved in that, so as to put forward the motorcyclist view.
Yeah.
In history, there's been too often where decisions about motorcycles have been taken by car drivers.
Yeah, sure.
Luckily,
or bureaucrats.
And bureaucrats.
Car driving bureaucrats. Okay. Who don't like motorcycles.
The really good thing that we saw with the Queensland licence change was the head of the committee in the department that was running it was a motorcyclist.
Awesome.
He demanded that every one of his representatives from the department, during the time that they were reviewing the licences system, went and got a motorcycle licence.
Yeah, that's
so they all understood exactly what they were looking at.
We've obviously, been talking about this throughout. The development of iRide and the program itself, and some of the things that we'd like to do, and maybe you can participate in that going forward, but some of the segments we'd like to do on the show is the perspective of a brand new rider, someone coming out and getting their license for the first time. What are the things they have to do, the process they have to go through to get their license, and how relevant is it to what actually real life experience is going to be like?
Mm. And whether they should be mandatory to do rider training. I think rider training is so important, and you can never get enough.
Yeah,
I've been riding for years and I still will go and do extra training.
That was the biggest problem.
As a refresher, I guess.
That was the biggest problem we had with our previous licensing system. There was no requirement for you to be able to prove that you could ride a motorcycle to get a learner's permit.
Yeah.
In other words, it was like giving somebody the keys to the car and say, I don't give a damn when you've got a license, just go out and play on the road.
I got my bike license, as I said, back in the 70s in a small country county. Watch me ride up and down the street.
You can ride. Talk to the local sergeant, you'll be nice to me today.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, look, there's lots and lots of really interesting stuff coming up. We've got in future shows, and Chris, if possible, we'd like to have you come back and occasionally just give us an update on different things as they occur, and we'll stay in touch, obviously. Thanks for coming on the show. We're probably running a little bit longer than we wanted to on the first show, but I've got to tell you what, it's been a heap of fun, and we're looking forward to maybe presenting some more shows in the future from different locations. We've got so many great ideas, haven't we, Kylie and Bob? We've got so much content that we want to talk about. And we want to make it technical. We want to talk about suspension. We want to talk about tyres. We want to talk about riding gear. We want to do bike reviews, road reviews, all sorts of things. There's so much stuff coming up, and it's all going to be very, very specific to motorcycle riders. So throw your ideas at us. Keep the comments coming. We're just really going to be feeding off the information you guys are going to be giving us in the future. The show is going to be put up onto YouTube, as I said, so you'll be able to go back and watch it. But you'll be able to continue to comment through the Facebook page, and we will continue to review those comments and take that feedback. So thanks very much for doing that. Now, I just want to say a huge thanks to Shane, where are you, mate? Over there somewhere, from Smoke Garage, just for allowing us to use this, and it's just been terrific. If you're a motorcycle-themed business, or you support the motorcycle industry, and you'd like to participate in future shows, maybe some sort of collaboration, sponsorship or partnership, we'd love to hear from you. Get in touch with us through the Facebook page. Just send us a message and we'll have a dialogue. We'd love to have a talk to you about the potential to speak directly to the motorcycle community, very, very specifically passionate motorcyclists. So that's really where we're going to be heading. So what else have we got coming up, Kylie? We're just about out of time. But what
yeah, so, we just wanted to say thank you, everyone, for watching tonight. We've got some fabulous footage from Dust Hustle. Thanks to Elispeed for allowing us to film that. And yes, but before we see this, we're going to say, we're going to have someone special say goodnight to us tonight.
Hi, my name is James. Watch iRide live, September 4, 7:30. Watch iRide live. Watch iRide. It's live. It's live. Life. Ah. Watch iRide. It's live. I. Ah. Always. Ah. Yeah. Yeah. Ready. Hi, my name is James. Live. Okay, life, 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 life. Watch iRide. Live. September 30. Ah, no. Hi, my name is James. Watch iRide. Life. I wait for you.
Hi. Well, my name is James. Watch iRide. Live. Oh, no. Live. Sorry. Live. we're here in a small garage, and
We waited for you.
Yeah.
We waited for you. We hope to see you again, James. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, mate. Thanks.
Thanks, everyone. And good night.
Thanks for watching and thanks for being part of it. Appreciate your communication and your comments and everything, and just been great. We'll see you next time.
Wait for you.
iRide Deliver, live online streaming.